it causes me to tremble. When they crucified my Lord, were you there when they nailed him to the tree? Were you there? Causes me to tremble. Were you there when they nailed him to the tree? Sometimes it causes me to tremble. Were you there when they laid him in the tomb?
Thank you so much for joining with us tonight, this Good Friday night, 2020. It'll be one that we never forget. I pray tonight would be an awesome time of worship for you and your family. I know it'll be an awesome time for us as a body of Christ, because tonight we're going to celebrate the Lord's Supper together, and I want you to know that you don't have to be a member of Charleston Baptist Church to do that. If you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, we would encourage you to celebrate the Lord's Supper with us together. And we're going to worship the Lord through song, through hearing His Word and responding to His Word, and we just want to prepare our hearts for all that God has in store for us. Again, we want to worship Him. Let us be reminded of the words of the prophet Isaiah in Isaiah chapter 53, who said these words: "He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and as one from whom men hid their faces. He was despised and we esteemed him not. Surely he was borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his stripes we are healed." Let us pray. Lord, we come to you tonight, and we just want to say thank you, that our hearts would be so filled with gratitude and thankfulness, that even in the midst of the circumstances that we're living in, Lord, we are so thankful for your grace. Lord, I pray tonight as we come to worship you, Lord, that we would do it in spirit and truth. Lord, that we would do it with great sincerity, and Lord, that our hearts would be genuine before you. Lord, that we would present to you our prayers and our praises. Lord, I pray that tonight we would continually be reminded of the words of the Apostle Paul, who told us in Colossians chapter 1, 28 and 29, that him we proclaim, warning everyone and teaching everyone with all wisdom, that we would present everyone mature in Christ. For this I toil, struggling with all his energy that so powerfully works within me. God, we praise you. We thank you for the person and work of Jesus Christ. We thank you for the Holy Spirit, who is not only our wonderful counselor, but he is also the great comforter. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Would you join with us as we sing about the wondrous cross?
Find that.
Thank you.
There's nothing greater than the cross, not simply because it's the cross, but because of the one who died for our sins on the cross. If you would open your Bibles to Romans chapter 3. Romans chapter 3, we're going to be in verses 21 through 31 tonight. If you're with us tonight and you have one of the church-provided blue Bibles, I would encourage you to take that Bible, open up to page 1042. 1042, the book of Romans was written by the Apostle Paul. It has some of the most theologically deep passages in the scripture pointing us to our need for Jesus. And some of my favorite passages are actually in the book of Romans. And if I were to ask you this question, what are some of your favorite Bible verses? What would you say? It's okay. Take a moment. Share those with the group that you're with. It's okay to talk in church. And we're having church service tonight. We're worshiping the Lord. Two of my favorite verses in the book of Romans happen in Romans chapter 1. In Romans chapter 1, verses 16 and 17, this is what the Apostle Paul says. He says, "For I am not ashamed." The word ashamed there means I'm not losing confidence in. What is he not losing confidence in? He says, "For I'm not ashamed of the gospel." The gospel being the good news of Jesus Christ, that God has come to rescue sinners. He says, "For it is the power," it's where we get the word English word dynamite from, "it's the power of God," so it's God's power, not our power, "for the power of God for salvation." Again, this understanding that even though man sinned, and when sin entered the world, God still gave us a promise that he was going to send a rescuer to us to bring about what? To bring about salvation, to bring us back into a right relationship with the Lord. And then he says, "To everyone who believes," and that is huge, especially in the book of Romans. Why? Because he says to the Jew first. Why the Jew first? Well, several reasons. Just a couple reasons that I'll mention. One, the Jews were the chosen people of God. Two, Jesus himself was a Jew. The Jews were the first to get the gospel message, and so that's some of the reasons why to the Jews first. But not just to the Jews, what does it say? And also to the Greek. The Greek would also be those who we would most commonly refer to as the Gentiles. So that would be everybody else that's not a Jew. And now, this is huge news for us. Why? Because the Jews, they didn't see the Gentiles as ones being able to receive salvation from the Lord. The Jews thought it was just them. They were the chosen race. And yet, you have these Gentiles who worshipped many gods, not the true God, but they worshipped many gods. And the scripture says that this message of salvation is for both the Jew and the Greeks, the Gentiles. And we think about racism today. We think about disunity today. There is far more greater disunity and dysfunction with these particular culture clashes between the Jews and the Greeks. And yet it tells us that the gospel itself, the good news, has the ability to not only bring people right into right relationship with one another, but most importantly, in a right relationship with the Lord. Now, how is that possible? Listen to what he says. He says, "For in it the righteousness," meaning there's something holy, there's something right, there's something perfect, of God is revealed, so it's manifested, it's given to us in the person and work of Jesus Christ, from faith for faith, as it is written, the righteous shall live by faith. These are great verses. But here's what we find in the book of Romans. From Romans chapter 1, verse 18, through Romans chapter 3, verse 20, we're really in a courtroom setting. And in that courtroom setting, you and I, both the Jews and the Greeks, the Gentiles, we're getting hammered. We have this defense that we're giving on why we're innocent, on why we can be right with God and should be right with God. And over again, the prosecution is bringing more evidence, mounting evidence against us on why we're not. In chapter 1, it talks about how we worship the created things and not the Creator. Speaking about our conscience, that our conscience even tells us that we're not right with God. In Romans chapter 2 and 3, we have the law that stands against us, that God's perfect law, His righteousness, stands against us. And then in Romans chapter 3, God Himself, the judge, gets in the courtroom. He says, even Him, He tells us that we are guilty of our sin. So by the time we get to Romans chapter 3, verse 20, man, there's a lot of despair. What hope do we have? How is it that you and I can be right with God? How is it that you and I can have the righteousness that God seeks after? Where are we going to get it from? And that's the beauty of Romans chapter 3, verses 21 through 31. It's the breath of fresh air that all humanity, you and I included, need. And in that those 11 verses, we get five incredible questions that need to be asked, but not just asked, they need to be answered. And so what do we see in Romans chapter 3, verses 21 through 31? What is the first question that we see? Well, the first question that comes out of these verses is, where is this righteousness going to come from? Where is it going to come from? Well, clearly, by the time we get to Romans chapter 3, verse 20, we know it's not going to come from us. It doesn't matter if you're part of the chosen race of the Jews or you're the Gentiles. It's not going to come from us. And so where does it come from? Well, that answer is this. It comes from God. It comes from God. Listen to what Paul says in verse 21. He says, but now, that's that breath of fresh air. There's a contrast of what has already been said to, there's something new on the table. There's not just something, it's someone. But now, the righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law. So it has been revealed to us apart from the law, although the law and the prophets bear witness to it. You see, the law is a ladder. It's a ladder to where we can't climb. We can't get to the top. You know, when the law was given, the Ten Commandments were given, when God gave those commandments to the people of Israel, he didn't give those with the understanding that the Israelites, the Jews, would look at it and say, you know what, I think I'm going to go out and I'm going to accomplish those things on my own. Quite the opposite. When God gave the Ten Commandments, which are for our good and for His glory, He gave those in such a way that when the Israelites would look at them, when you and I would look at them, we would say, you know what, there is absolutely no way that I can measure up to those Ten Commandments. I need some help. I need something outside of me in order to live out those beautiful truths that are found in the Scripture. And so the prophets, they even speak of this. Every prophet in the Old Testament are pointing us to something that is bigger than ourselves. And so where does this righteousness come from? It comes from God Himself. Now that leads us to the next question. How do I receive God's righteousness? How do I receive it? If we know it doesn't come from works, it doesn't come from our ability to be good and less evil than the person next to us. How do we receive it? Well, it comes from faith. So it's not from works, it's from faith. Paul says in verse 22, the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. Those are beautiful words. To everyone in Jesus Christ. To all who believe. The wording there for Jesus Christ is beautiful in the book of Romans, because this is only the second time that Jesus Christ is mentioned specifically with that language in the book of Romans. The first time it's mentioned is in Romans chapter 2, when Jesus Christ comes to avenge wrath and anger against sinners like you and I. But now when we get to Romans chapter 3, the second time that it's used, Jesus Christ, He doesn't come to bring about wrath and anger. He comes to bring about what? Salvation. Grace and mercy coming from the name of Jesus Christ. And the beauty of this salvation is not from works at all. How do we know? Well, it says in the second part of verse 22, for there is what? There is no distinction. The cross brings about a level playing field. that it has nothing to do with your family heritage. It has nothing to do with your race or your culture or your educational achievements or your ability to be good or not good. The playing field has been leveled. And why has it been leveled? Why is there no distinction? Well, Paul says in verse 23, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." You see, God doesn't play any favorites whatsoever. Why? Because we all stand guilty before his holiness. And yet, when we realize the beautiful truth that the righteousness that we need comes from God, and the way that we receive his righteousness comes through faith, that leads us to our third question. And our third question is this: what does it mean to receive God's righteousness through faith? What does that mean? Well, Paul mentions some incredible biblical truths in this particular passage. And the first answer that he gives us on what this righteousness means is this: I am justified. As a believer in Jesus Christ, today you stand justified. He says in verse 24, "And are justified by his grace as a gift." Now, that word justified is a legal term. So we have to go back into that courtroom, the same courtroom that said that we were guilty, that we had sinned against us, sinned towards the Lord. Now the scripture says that we are justified in the righteousness that God brings to us. That word justified is important. Again, it's a legal term, so we're back in the courtroom. And the word justified is a declaration that you and I are innocent in Christ. Justification is not a process, a journey that we go on trying to again earn our way to innocence before the Lord. At the very moment that you come into a right relationship with the Lord, you are fully justified. It's a declaration. You can't get any more justified than you are right now in the Lord. You will forever be justified. Now, how is this possible? Well, Paul says it's a gift. It's a gift. It's a grace gift. Now, that word gift is an interesting word too, because Jesus uses this same word in John chapter 15 when he's talking about his enemies, those who are out to persecute him. And this is what he says in John 15 verse 25. He says, "They hated me without cause." That phrase, "without cause," is the same word for gift in Romans chapter 3 verse 24. So here we have Jesus, who was innocent, has been gifted death. And you and I, who are guilty because of Christ, we have been gifted life. So not only are we justified, not only are we innocent before the Lord because of Jesus Christ, but Paul says that we have been redeemed. We have been redeemed. Paul says in the second part of verse 24 that through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. There are several words that are used for the word redemption in the New Testament. Most often, when the Apostle Paul talks about it, he talks about this buying, this purchasing. It reminds me of Chuck E. Cheese. How many of you all have ever been to Chuck E. Cheese? Next question, how many of you like going to Chuck E. Cheese? So sometimes we have two different answers there. I personally love going to Chuck E. Cheese. I love playing the games. My wife, on the other hand, she doesn't like going to Chuck E. Cheese. But I will say that if she's playing skee ball, don't get anywhere near her, because if she's in that backswing and you touch her hand, you're going to get the eyebrow raise. And I'm pretty sure she got the eyebrow raise from my father-in-law, as you know, Pastor Jack. And so just get away from her. And what do? You go around Chuck E. Cheese, you eat a little bit of pizza. For you health nuts, you might have a salad, get some wings. You play a bunch of games, and you play games that spit out tickets, right? And so after you play your games and spend a bunch of money, you get all your tickets, and what do? You take those tickets and you take them to the redemption counter. And what do? You place those tickets on the redemption counter and you look at some things that you want. And in exchange, the person behind that counter gives you some kind of toy. I don't know about you, but we probably have three or four multicolored Slinkies at our house that are all messed up and the kids want you to fix them. And guess what? You just can't fix them. That's one of the ways that you can define redemption in the New Testament, but that's not what Paul does here. He uses a different way of defining redemption. It's the idea of paying a ransom. Paying a ransom. You see, you and I, we are in bondage to our sin. That is the the slyness of sin. Oftentimes we approach sin of how close can we get to the line? How can we play with sin? How can we make it our buddy? How can we enjoy it? But while that's happening in our mind, Satan, on the other hand, is saying, ha, 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 the closer you get, the more bondage that you're in. And so we think we can control it. We think we can manipulate it. But the reality is, any form of sin whatsoever, sin that is seen or unseen, really has you in captivity. It has you in bondage. You are slave to it. And the scripture says that we are condemned to death because of our sin. And yet, because of this redemption, Jesus pays the ransom for our debt, a debt that you and I could never pay. He pays it in full. And not only does he pay it, he sets us free. So not only is the penalty of our sin canceled in Jesus Christ, but the power of sin is canceled because we are in Jesus Christ. We have a new king. We have a new master. And he brings us an entirely new life. But it wasn't free. Someone had to pay that price. And that leads us to the fourth question. Why did God choose to do it this way? Why did he choose to send Jesus Christ on this rescue mission? Why did he choose to make sure from day one that it wasn't a plan of salvation based on works, but one of faith that is given to us because of the grace of the Lord? Well, he does it in order to demonstrate his character, the Lord's character. Paul says in verse 25, whom God put forward as a propitiation by his blood to be received by faith. This was to show God's righteousness because in his divine forbearance, he had passed over former sins. You might have picked up on a word there, propitiation. It's an incredible word, and that word defines a substitute. A substitute was given to us, that meaning that someone stood in our place, and you and I know that that person is Jesus Christ. And his blood was shed on the cross, not just any blood, the sinless, pure blood of the one and only Son of God, again, Jesus Christ. And in that substitution, in that propitiation, the great exchange occurred. And we needed two things to happen in that moment. We needed the righteousness of God, and we also needed the wrath of God to be appeased. It needed to be dealt with. And so it's a beautiful thing to know that not only did the blood of Christ cover our sins, but it also covered the wrath of God. It's a picture in the Old Testament, specifically if you go to the book of Leviticus, Leviticus 16, Leviticus 17, where the high priest would go into the Holy of Holies, and there the Ark of Covenant would be, and once a year he would go in there and he would take the sacrificial blood of the lamb and he would pour it over the mercy seat, and that blood being sprinkled over the mercy seat would bring cleansing to the people's sins. The issue was, the next day when somebody mouthed off to their mom at the dinner table, guess what? They needed another sacrifice. Well, that cycle continued year after year for centuries until Jesus came. When Jesus came, when he came to atone for our sins, he came and he finished the sacrifice, the very last and final sacrifice. Jesus took our place and absorbed the full wrath of God. And how is that given to us? It's given to us by faith. So he did it in order to display what? His kindness towards sinners. God is a kind God. In fact, if you look at Romans chapter 2, verse 4, the scripture says, or do you presume on the riches of his kindness and forbearance and patience, not knowing that God's kindness is meant to lead you to repentance? The kindness of the Lord leads sinners like you and I to repentance. You know, you may ask yourself, how is it that the Old Testament saints were able to be saved? Well, the same way that you and I are able to be saved. By faith in Jesus Christ. Whereas we look back to the cross and what Jesus accomplished on the cross and put our faith in him and what he accomplished, the Old Testament saints would look forward to the cross, the promised Messiah, and they would put their faith in what the Lord had said to them. Though they did not understand it as fully as we do, they still put their faith in the Lord. Now the question is, yes, we want God to be kind, but at the same time, God must be just. That sin needed to be punished. How is it possible? We ask the wrong question because we have a man-centered view of God oftentimes. How could a loving God send people to hell? That's the wrong question. The right question is, how can a holy God allow sinners to go to heaven, be in right relationship with him? How is that possible? Well, the justice of God needed to be dealt with. And Paul says in verse 26, it was to show his righteousness at the present time. So he did it his way by sending Jesus to demonstrate the characteristics of kindness and justice. Scripture says his righteousness at the present time, so that he might be what? Just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. It reminds me of a story called The Merciful King, and I'll read it to you. It says, once upon a time in a kingdom far, far away, there lived a great king. He was simultaneously the most powerful man in the kingdom, as well as the kindest and gentlest man in the whole realm. The kingdom was known for its peace, harmony, and goodwill. Neighbors cherished one another, and years would pass without a single crime being committed. One day, however, the chief servant of the merciful king came into the throne room with ill tidings. There is a thief in the realm of your kingdom, sire, said the servant. The king was astonished. Find that thief, and when you do bring him to me, he will be punished with 10 lashes. Those in the room were astonished as well. It had been so long since a crime had been committed, they could hardly imagine who would have done such a thing. A week went by, and the servant again made his way to the throne room. I have bad news for you, sire, quietly reported the servant. The thief has not been found, and he continues to rob from your people. In anger, the king raised his hand and his voice and said, find the thief, and when you do, he will receive 15 lashes. The people began to murmur among themselves, who could withstand such a punishment? Who could possibly be committing such a crime? As time went on, the servant once again came back into the throne room with yet another bad report. Your Majesty, the thief has not been found. We have searched in vain for him. Your people are still being robbed. The king was enraged. Find that wretched thief, and you, when you do, I will punish him with 50 lashes. Now the people were filled with dread. They were not even sure the king himself could withstand such a punishment. And if he couldn't, then certainly no one else could. Who could be doing such a thing? Well, soon after, the servant again approached the king in his throne room. His face was pale. His voice was timid and hollow. Your Highness, spoke the servant, the thief has been found. Bring that person to me in an instant, the king said. The crowd that had poured into the throne room slowly parted, revealing the thief, who now stood trembling in the middle of the room. To the utter shock and dismay of all, it was the king's aged mother. There she stood, trembling and crying. Her small and frail body was shaking due to fear and shame. She was perhaps the very last soul that any would suspect of such a crime. And there stood the king in shock and deeply wounded. The crowd began to wonder and murmur among themselves, what will the merciful king do? Will he set aside the law and display his love and mercy by forgiving his own mother of her crimes? Or will he display his sovereignty and justice by giving her exactly what she deserved? Will he choose mercy, or will he choose justice? The king raised his hand to quiet the crowd. He said, bring out the whipping post. The crowd was dumbfounded. Would the king truly have his mother receive this type of punishment? 50 lashes. Even the king could scarcely survive such a flogging. This frail woman wouldn't even last a few strokes. The old woman was tied to the post. Her garment was ripped, exposing her back to the whipmaster. Her ribs could be counted because of her frailty. Administer the lashes, the king said. No one could make a sound. They were astonished. But just as the whipmaster was about to unleash his first stroke, the king, he cried out, "Halt! Halt!" The crowd sighed in utter relief, but that feeling didn't last for long. The king stood from his throne. He slowly removed the crown off his head and put it on his chair. He began to walk down the stairs to his mother. He laid aside his royal robe and finely woven tunic. Coming to his mother, he wrapped his enormous body around her frail body and said, now you can administer the lashes. Thus, in one act, did the king display pure mercy and perfect justice. Why did God choose to do it this way? To demonstrate his character. And that leads us to a fifth and final question that we must ask and answer. And that is this: what are the results of God doing it this way? What are the results when you and I come to faith in Jesus Christ by his grace and not by works? Well, three things. One, we cannot boast in ourselves. That's what Paul says. Listen to what he says in verse 27 through 28. He says, "Then what becomes of our boasting? It is excluded. By what kind of law? By a law of works? No, but by a law of faith. For we hold that one is justified by faith apart from the works of the law." That is our only hope, faith in Jesus Christ. So you and I, we cannot boast. Secondly, Paul says, there's only one way. There's only one way as a result of God doing it his way. It says in verses 29 through 30, "Or is God the God of the Jews only? If he is not the God of the Gentiles also, yes, of Gentiles also. Since God is one, who will justify the circumcised by faith and the uncircumcised through faith?" And so, it's a beautiful two verses here. One, it tells us that there is only one way. Why? Because both the Jew and the Greek, the Gentile, can receive the righteousness of Christ in the same way. So no one is excluded. No culture, no race, no economic background, no political alignment. None of those things can get in the way of you and I receiving the righteousness of Christ by grace through faith. And the third result that we find when God did it his way is that the law served its purpose. The law served its purpose. Paul says in verse 31, "Do we then overthrow the law by this faith? By no means. On the contrary, we uphold the law." It's important for us to know that when we read the scripture, especially in the New Testament, in no way whatsoever is Paul putting the gospel against the law or the law against the gospel. Jesus Christ himself said he came not to abolish the law, but to fulfill the law. The question is, what is compelling us? What is motivating us? What is our ability to fulfill the law that God has given? Again, the law reflects the glory of the Lord. Well, it's not us. It's the Holy Spirit of God. Paul says in Romans 8, verses 2 through 4, "For the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus from the law of sin and death. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do. By sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin he condemned sin in the flesh, in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit." Now you and I, as brothers and sisters in Christ, we have the Holy Spirit of God, our counselor, our comforter, giving us desire and power to fulfill the commands that God has given to us for his glory and for our blessing. So let's go back to our first two verses that we looked at tonight. Romans 1, 16 and 17. "For I am not ashamed of the gospel. For it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith for faith, as it is written, the righteous shall live by faith. Why is it that you and I can stand here tonight and not be ashamed of the gospel, not lose confidence in the gospel? Well, because our righteousness comes from God through faith. And in him we are fully justified and fully redeemed. And because he demonstrated his character in the way that he has, none of us can boast. No one is excluded. There's only one way. And you and I can live the life that God has called us to live through the power of his Holy Spirit that is within us. I pray that our message tonight has helped prepare your heart for celebrating the Lord's Supper. I want to remind you of what Paul says in 1 Corinthians 11. He says, "For I received from the Lord what I also deliver to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and blood of the Lord. Let a person examine himself then, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup." Before we celebrate the Lord's Supper together, I think it would be very wise for us to take a moment to reflect on the message from God's word, that we would consider the circumstances that we're facing today, and we would ask the Lord through his Spirit and through his gospel to examine our hearts. And so before we celebrate the Lord's Supper together, we're going to take a moment and we are going to just worship the Lord through song. And at the same time, we're just going to take some time and just examine our hearts. Is there any sin between us and the Lord? Is there any unconfessed, unrepentant sin? Is there anything that's providing an obstacle between us and the Lord as we want to celebrate the Lord's Supper together? I pray that you would take this opportunity to spend time with him.
You suffered in my life.
so all might see the strength to follow your commands could never come from me. Oh, Father, use my ransom life in any way you choose, and let my song forever be my only boast is you. Hallelujah.
What a beautiful song, reminding us that all we have is Christ. At this time, as we transition to celebrating the Lord's Supper together, I do want to just give a couple instructions. If you're using one of the church-provided pre-filled juice cups with the bread, give you a couple hints because I had to practice myself. All you got to do is push down fully on the whole tab. It'll lift up a clear tab. Pull that tab up. That'll get you the bread. And then very carefully, you can lift up on the other tab, and that will give you the juice. Go ahead and take a moment to go ahead and get yourself and your family ready. I also want to remind everybody that you do not have to be a member of Charleston Baptist Church to celebrate the Lord's Supper together tonight. This is the Lord's Supper. This is not the Charleston Baptist Supper. But you do need to know the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. So I pray that is where you're at right now, that you would celebrate the Lord's Supper together as brothers and sisters in Christ, that though we are separated in many ways because of the current situation that we're living in, because we have one spirit, we are in one body, and we praise the Lord for that. Remember the words of the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. He said, "For I received from the Lord what I also deliver to you, that the Lord Jesus on the night when he was betrayed took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" At this time, if you would, go ahead and take the bread. In the same way, also, he took the cup after supper, saying, This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Please go ahead and take the cup. For the next several minutes, I would just encourage you to just reflect on all that has happened tonight in our time of worship. As a family, if you're with your family or your friends, maybe there's some confession of sin that needs to happen within your small group. I pray that you would just take this time and just worship the Lord, meditate on Him, ask the Holy Spirit of God to give you comfort and peace and power and strength, and that nothing in this world will rob us of the joy that we have in Christ. Let us continue to worship Him as we spend time with Him in silent prayer. I don't know about you, but this has been an incredible night of worship for me. I pray that it has been the same for you. I know that during these times, especially this Good Friday night, there's probably so many things going through your heart and your mind, so many things that you may be struggling with or things that you're praising right now because of the goodness of our Lord. And we want to connect with you as best as we possibly can. On our church website, right underneath the message or worship service tonight, you'll see a little connection card tab there. We'd love to connect with you. If you have a prayer request or a praise that you would like for us to uplift on your behalf, if you have questions about a relationship with the Lord, maybe there's some counsel that you may need, or if you'd like to get a part of a life group or places of service, whatever your decision is, if you want more information about Charleston Baptist Church, we'd love to connect with you. Don't let what the Holy Spirit is doing in your life right now be hindered by delay. Go right now, go to the church website, fill out the connection card, and we'll get in touch with you as soon as we possibly can. Thank you again for joining with us this Friday night, Good Friday service. I want you to know that Sunday's coming.
It's Friday. Jesus is praying. Peter's asleep. Judas is betraying, but Sunday's coming. It's Friday. Pilate's struggling. The council is conspiring. The crowd is vilifying. They don't even know that Sunday's coming. It's Friday. The disciples are running like sheep without a shepherd. Mary's crying. Peter is denying. But they don't know that Sundays are coming. It's Friday. The Romans beat my Jesus. They robe him in scarlet. They crown him with thorns, but they don't know that Sunday's coming. It's Friday. See Jesus walking to Calvary, his blood dripping, his body stumbling, and his spirit's burdened. But you see, it's only Friday. Sunday's coming. It's Friday. The world's winning. People are sinning, and evil's grinning. It's Friday. The soldiers nailed my Savior's hands to the cross. They nailed my Savior's feet to the cross. And then they raised him up next to criminals. It's Friday. But let me tell you something. Sunday's coming. It's Friday. The disciples are questioning what has happened to their king. And the Pharisees are celebrating that their scheming has been achieved. But they don't know. It's only Friday. Sunday's coming. It's Friday. He's hanging on the cross, feeling forsaken by his Father, left alone and dying. Can nobody save him? Oh, it's Friday, but Sunday's coming. It's Friday, the earth trembles, the sky grows dark, my King yields his spirit. It's Friday. Hope is lost. Death has won. Sin has conquered. And Satan's just a laughing. It's Friday. Jesus is buried. A soldier stands guard. And a rock is rolled into place. But it's Friday. It is only Friday. Sunday is a coming.